which required a shining virtuosic fingerwork against horns in the palace. The requirement to play multiple pitches with one foot presents unique challenges for the player. Because the weight of the foot is unevenly distributed, the player must constantly be aware of pressing the two or more pedals at the same time to avoid a broken cord effect. AT2 also requires the assistance beyond simply drawing stops. One assistant must also be in the working case to, quote, reach into the designated heights with two fingers and thus create an irregular paralleling effect, which also influences the pitch. End quote. Another assistant is instructed to, quote, low irregularly into the external organ heights and change the pitch by changing the position of the mouth. The two assistants thus aid in continuing and augmenting the mysterious field of the AT. AT3 is a fast and furious perpetual mobile, perpetual motion piece in the manuals against chords in the pedals. Pelzel expands the virtuosity in the hands by constantly confusing the meter of the piece, shifting rapidly from 6/8 to 5/8 to 9/8 to 9/16, and various other meters throughout. He has also built a pedal virtuosity required in AT2, using 3 and 4 note chords in the pedal through much of the Pelzel states that one of his goals in writing this work was to, quote, show in a way something special of the instrument, end quote. He says that the AT2s are not just to be virtuosic in a superficial way, but should go beyond simply showcasing the performer's and the composer's technique. AT2s should open into something much more artistically interesting. The virtuosity demonstrated in this work makes it an AT2 not only for the player, but also for the instrument and the listener. For Pelzel, the drive to create something artistic yet original spurred him to write pieces treating the organ in a different way. The result is the Trois et Demi Baïtons. Rachel Bonheur, born 1961, Canada. Etude Symphonique pour pedal solo, variations for that good old Baylor line, 2014. In English, and give them an underlying narrative. This applies even with pieces that are not overtly programmatic or evocative in type. Her output includes three separate creations, each done by a clinician. Etude Softly or Penanzola was commissioned by Isabel Demers, organ professor at Baylor University. Dr. Demers requested a set of creations for pedal solo based on Baylor school song, That Good Old Baylor Line. Because of Dr. Demers' express wish to improve her pedal technique, Lara experimented heavily with each of the variations, exploring as many facets of pedal technique as possible in one piece. The theme is presented without ornamentation in the pedal, with an optional manual part to harmonize the theme if the player desires. Each phrase of the theme begins with an arpeggio from 10D up to D above middle C. The similarity of phrases gives the piece a form of A, A prime, A double prime. Each variation then works out a different technical problem encountered when playing the pedals. Variation 1 has groups of three notes, with the first two notes being slurred and the third note being detached. The goal is to follow the articulation pattern laid out without choking the sail on the second or third note of the pattern. Variation 2 has the right foot and left foot playing a similar pattern to each other, but it is offset by a 16-note pulse. This gives a march-like hoo-hah feel to the piece and allows the performer to practice playing the right foot somewhat detached while playing the left foot staccato. Variation 3 is a perpetual motion movement with 16 notes throughout. It requires rapid shifts from one end of the pedal board to the other. Variation 4 at first feels like a reprieve from the more virtuosic elements in the previous variations. The manuals are reintroduced, and for the first 31 measures, the pedal focuses more on creating a musical singing line than virtuosic technique. However, measures 31 through 35 introduce the most controversial moment in the pedal up to this point. Each foot is playing a completely independent line from the other. After these measures, the pedal returns to the same beautiful line. Variation 5 implements brace notes in the pedal, while variation 6 showcases organ scales, both chromatic and diatonic. Variation 7 alternates slow legato sections with faster, more upbeat sections. Each iteration of the slow section provides more decoration. For measures 1 through 3, the line is presented with no decoration. The second time the scene is played, from the Variation 8 introduces the new ideas of pedal octaves and pedal chords. Similar to Klenzel's etudes, the player must position the foot to come down on the correct pitches using the weight of the foot in a balanced way, so neither the heel nor toe strike perfectly. Variation 9 again feels like a short reprieve. It focuses on various articulation patterns, ranging from staccato to slightly detached to slurs in a variety of places in measure, even over bar lines. Variation 10 focuses on playing parallel thirds in the pedals. Variation 11 treats the feet in a solo accompaniment style with a swing rhythm reminiscent of jazz. The left foot plays a descending chromatic tetrachord accompaniment while the right foot plays the solo line. The final variation sees the return of the manual. According to Lohan, the manual part adds beauty and helps to give a conclusory feel to the piece. This movement is a pedal brother run movement. The pedal plays rapid passages of 16 and 30 second notes, requiring great facility, a toe-heel technique to play. It is a fitting end to a difficult set. Commissioned in 2003 for the Flamme de Bois organ competition in Canada, Etude Héroïque is intended to showcase the colors of the organ as well as the virtuosity of the performer. Additionally, Laura notes that one of the main objectives of this piece was to test the capacity of the performer to make transitions sections in a musical way. Etude Héroïque is a rondo form with an introduction. The piece begins with alternating 16th note quarter note patterns in hands and feet, followed by a lengthy pedal solo requiring rapid rocking from toe to heel in the right. After the introduction and theme A, theme B enters with big technical hands as shown in example 24. The hands must display complete finger independence, with one voice in each hand playing the melodic line, against a second voice in each hand playing a rhythmic ostinato pattern. The pedal also participates in the rhythmic ostinato pattern with particular emphasis on rapid alternating toe-heel patterns. Laurette notes that she wanted to, quote, develop also a lot of manual pianistic technique for the organ. In this vein, there are several challenging manual techniques employed throughout this work. From measure 59 through 64, the hands play staccato parallel thirds at a rapid pace. Measures 115 through 122 feature alternating chords in the hands, and measure 140 has alternating octaves in the hands. The final etude by Rochelle Laurel, Etude Capri Foro, La Rue de Lensburg, was commissioned by Ken Cowan, Associate Professor of Organ at Rice University. Cowan specifically requested a piece that could be programmed in the middle of a recital that would end softly, and that could be considered scherzando, or playful, Laurel, in searching for inspiration, drew from two These two sources became the two main themes encountered in the piece. The Devil's Laugh theme, for example, letters 1 through 23, presented at the beginning of the piece, is based on a simple pattern of two 16 notes followed by an eighth note, with descending or rising chromatic motion. The Fly theme, for example, letters 24 through 44, is a lyrical melody accompanied above or below with chromatic 16-note motion, almost as a fly buzzing around while some of the text go out of their order. There are several virtuosic techniques Laura develops for this piece. From the beginning, which is required to play bracelets and quick skip. Set a two more than this ideology, as all of them are short pieces that communicate a view or emotion. Lebrun also tries to limit the number of technical skills developed in his works. He feels that each etude should work on one to two skills in short, concentrated works, rather than as an extended work that tries to work on all the technical aspects possible. His seven short pedal etudes follow this philosophy. Etude 1, Molto Vivo, opens with a pedal trill in one foot. This is followed by a specific articulation pattern that unifies the piece. Three staccato eighth notes, followed by two slurred 16th notes. Etude 2, Mesto, features two completely independent lines for each foot. The difficulty, however, lies in the rocking motion of one foot from heel to toe on broken thirds against a legato melodic line. The rocking motion is passed to each foot at various moments in the piece. Etude 3, Stringendo, requires the rapid alternation of the toes of each foot. To execute some of the repeated note passages correctly, it requires alternating the toes on the same pitch, as in measures 8 through 9. Etude 4, Melancholia, is a slow and legato movement. In this particular movement, Lebrun requires the organist to play a legato line with skips, a seconds and thirds in one foot. This can be seen in measure 6, where the right foot must stretch from a G flat down to a D natural, and from an E natural up to a D flat. This piece also explores pedal chords with particular emphasis on repeating or changing a note of the chord while the other chord tone is pulled. Consider, for example, measures 12 through 13 and 17 through 18. In measures 12 through 13, the right tone must re-articulate the D while holding the C with the heel. In measures 17 through 18, the right tone must move smoothly from B flat to A to G and back to B flat, while the right heel holds a G. Etude 5, Leggero, works on two main skips, the first from measures 1 through 17 and 41 through 53. Focuses on transitioning from heel to toe in one foot to heel to toe in the other foot. The trick is not necessarily in the motion, but in creating the legato line between the two feet, as well as keeping the line rigid and dragging without shortening or lengthening any tones. The middle section measures 18 through 40, focused on parallel thirds combined with a particular slur pattern, either over two eighth notes or over a quarter note eighth note pair. Etude 6, Sostenuto, is another slow legato movement. Within this movement, the difficulties stem mostly from the juxtaposition of triple patterns against duple patterns. This is evident in measure 6, where the basically a gene. It requires much skill in the way of alternating the tones, but with the added difficulty of ascending and descending scalar patterns at various moments. LeBlanc feels that these etudes should be executed without any undue noise from the pedal, thus requiring the feet to move seamlessly to where they must play. He also suggests that the order of difficulty of the etudes is from least to most difficult. Etude 6, etude 4, etude 1, etude 3, etude 5, etude 7, and most difficult, etude 2. S. Andrew Lloyd, born 1979, United States. Etudes, composed in 2014. Etude 7, composed in 2019. S. Andrew Lloyd describes his compositional style as a, quote, constant state of exploration, end quote. He seeks to experiment with every new piece he composes, using the study of other composers as a foundation for his work. The five etudes in the collection, Etudes, were written as part of his doctoral capstone project and exemplify the idea of experimentation. Three of the etudes, numbers 1, 2, and 4, are transcriptions of piano works he had previously written, Prelude 1, Prelude 2, and Prelude 4, respectively, from his collection Preludes, Book 1. While two etudes, numbers 3 and 5, are original to this collection, Lloyd notes that though they are certainly studies in technical aspects, quote, for the most part, I feel they are more studies of compositional craft and symbolism, end quote. Lloyd also notes that the collection, quote, similar to Daniel Book 3, Etudes illustrates and pays homage to a number of traditional forms and styles, including the Prelude of View, Sonata Allegro form, the Chorale, and the Toccata, among others. Alongside these compositional studies, the five pieces also exhibit several technical requirements, left-hand virtuosic passages, the use of key weights, rapid manual changes, polyvocal scales, hand leads, repeated notes, and pedal virtuosity. Finally, Etudes tells a story of life, death, and resurrection. The pieces are imbued with religious and spiritual symbolism, more common to the large-scale orders of Olivier Messiaen. End quote. The idea of connecting music with religious symbolism and programmatic elements is very common among organ composers, and recognizing this lends a greater understanding to the pieces. Etude 1, Prelude, is a study in two main aspects, left-hand dexterity and polyrhythmic proficiency. Throughout most of the work, the left hand is playing rapid arpeggiations across several octaves. Due to the tonal centers of the piece, the left hand must execute several uncomfortable technical skills, such as crossing the thumb under the forefinger and landing on a black note, see measure 5, for example. While the left hand is playing these rapid passages, the right hand and pedal create a sense of rhythmic ambiguity due to the polygons competing against each other. This can most easily be seen in measures 32 through 35, where the right hand must play quintuplets, triplets, eighth-notes, and gradually accelerating repeated note patterns against the steady 32nd notes of the left hand. The pedal, while not technically difficult, does not fit easily into the rhythm planes of the right hand and left hand, and thus adds to the polyrhythmic complexity displayed in this piece. The next piece of the collection, Etude 2, Introduction and Fugue, is a compositional study on fugal form. Lloyd instructs the performer to utilize a non-vowel style of touch, commonly associated with early organ performance practice. Within that framework, the organist also works on the technical skill of repeated notes. At the organ, repeated notes present various problems due to the varying speech of each stop. A reed stop, for example, tends to speak slower than a flute stop. The amount of space given between repeated notes can also affect the flow of a piece. This etude, then, can be seen as a study in the amount of time and weight given to repeated notes, as well as the amount of space between repeated notes. The third piece, Etude 3, Triptych, comes in three sections, as the title suggests. The first section works on making rapid manual changes along with the accelerometers. Section 2 focuses on pedal lyricism, while the final section focuses on lyricism and rubato technique in all the parts. Throughout this movement, there are also many passages with polymodal passing. Etude 4, Chorale, is a compositional study on the use of the chorale. There are many large beats, polymodal scales, often played against each other, and manual changes. The final etude, Etude 5, Response, is another study in repeated notes, this time with the repeated note motive shared between the hands. After composing this collection of etudes, Lloyd received a commission to write another piece. The resulting composition was subsequently titled Etude 7. This begs the question, where is Etude 6? When asked about this, Lloyd states that after writing it, it felt more like an Etude 7 than an Etude 6. He then goes on to say that it is a reflection of his views on time, asking, quote, "Why do we need to have 6 before 7? End quote. The philosophical implications of this idea are interesting, but beyond the scope of this paper. Etude 7 utilizes several numbers-based compositional techniques. The main theme of the piece is based on a motive that begins by a note, goes down by a minor second, up a minor third, down a minor second, up a major third, down a minor second, up a perfect fourth, down a minor second, etc. When these intervals are combined, this starts to sound like a motive B-A-C-H. Placing this piece among those historically composed with this motive in mind. Another major compositional technique is the use of the Fibonacci sequence. number 9, G is struck 8 times for the first 3 numbers of the sequence. The next iteration is from measures 46 through 53, in which G is struck 6 times, ushering in a new segment of the piece focused on rapid passage for the hands. The final iteration is in measures 73 through 79, where G is struck 10 times. This too leads into a new section of held chords just before a virtuosic display of rapid passage work and pedal work, leading to the grand closing cadence on a G major triad. Thomas Laporte, born 1982, France. Études for Or, Premier Pari, composed in 2016. In English, Etudes for Organ, First Note, and Etudes for Organ, Deuxième Cadre, composed in 2016. In English, Etudes for Organ, Second Note. Thomas Laporte, the organist at La Trinité in Paris, wrote his first etude after a friend asked him to compose a piece. Previously, Laporte had not thought to write organ music, instead relying on his improvisational skills whenever he had to create music at the organ. Additionally, he does not write organ music to play for himself, only for others. He feels this allows him to use more creativity in his compositions. Laporte's six etudes, spread out between two volumes, show a unique approach to technical development at the organ. He recognizes that the dimensions of some of his pieces do not fit the YouTube tradition, particularly with regards to length. The poetic titles and aspects of the pieces also stray from the tradition. However, he feels they fit into the genre of etude, maybe as, quote, an etude about the organ, or even maybe from the organ, end quote. Two of the three etudes in Volume 1, Alluvium in Flamme, Alluvium in Flame, and Et Nuit Bordeaux in Trompette Marine, and The Only String of Marine Trumpets, explore similar techniques. Both have extreme rhythmic complexity, requiring the player to employ complex cross rhythms in multiple parts, sometimes simultaneously, sometimes shifting the subdivisions from beat to beat. Each also has extended notation, meaning that Laporte created new notational symbols to convey his ideas more accurately. For example, in measures 41 and 45 of Alluvium, Laporte indicates two new types of fermatas. The first, shaped as a triangle with a dot in the middle, means a very short fermata. The second, shaped like three sides of a rectangle with a dot in the middle, means a short fermata. The typical fermata sign is also used to indicate more lengthy pauses or held notes. Another new notational idea is when he wants a note to be held indefinitely. He will indicate the notes to be held with open, not filled, note heads, with a tie, the for example, measure 27 and head to the loop. Key weights also come into play to hold pitches without the need for the player to hold them with their own hands. This opens more possibilities for playing around the elbows, as in measures 42 through 64 in Aguillon. The other way to do in this collection, Vidi Tiamat Scott, is in three large sections, each developing a different technical idea. The first section, from markers 1 through 37, works on octaves of various sizes between the hands and the head. After a brief transition at marker 38, section 2 begins at marker 39. This section is a study in held pedaloids with rapid passive work above. It also becomes a study in time notes amidst the passive work as in markers 41 through 46. Another short transition at marker 47 gives way to the final section, a study in scales. The right hand and left hand scales are layered on top of each other to create the effect of moving continuously upward. Note that though the left hand is written in a lower octave than the right hand, both hands will sound in the same tessitura because the right hand is registered with a 4-foot flute sounding an octave higher than the rhythm, and the left hand is registered with a 2-foot flute sounding 2 octaves higher than the rhythm. To add more difficulty, there seems to be very little pattern in how hold and access are used, making the scales difficult to execute simultaneously. This section is also difficult because of the continued technique of held pedaloids, along with the prestissimo tempo indication. The etudes in volume 2 tend to build on the same techniques mentioned above. The first and third etude in volume 2, the fifth hammer, and etude de transparence, transparency study, are unique in this study and the ordered repertoire for being ordered etudes for two players, four hands, two feet. They employ many of the same techniques listed previously from the first volume, but the addition of another player adds the rhythmic complexity. Another aspect is the communication between players. These pieces are not easy to read together, so this becomes an agent of communication with the other player, as well as the technical requirements for each individual playing the piece. When asked why he wrote etudes for two players, Lecoq spoke about his hammer experimentation at the organ. He talked about the difficulty for one player to create the same overtone series as a cornet or jeu de tierce, but instead using a string stop or a bassoon stop. It also became very difficult to get all the different timbres he wanted across 3 or 4 manuals with only 2 hands. The solution wasn't right for 4 hands and 2 feet. The other feature of volume 2 is Quilisma. This etude is very similar to the etude Aguillon from volume 1. However, this etude seems to be a study in time. Although the whole piece is not like this, markers 38 through 41 illustrate what feels like a suspension in time. Lecoq has indicated only chords, and he has written the desired duration above the notes in the score. This seems seems to suspect the natural inclination of music as being goal-oriented, instead allowing music to simply float or play. All the ancients, by the note, have another important technical aspect in common: resonance. Each piece works best in an acoustic environment as the hook seeks to play with the resonance of stops, the reverberation of stops in the acoustic, and the different overtones of the stops. Possibly because of this, Lacote states, quote, "If there is a pedagogical aspect in our pieces, it is obviously pedagogy of the ear, because it obliges you, as an organist, to listen to something you sometimes don't listen to." David Briggs, born in 1962, United Kingdom. Four concert etudes composed in 2005. David Briggs describes his compositional style as a mélange of other composers who have inspired him, including Claude Debussy, Paul Dukas, Lili Boulanger, Maurice Dauphin, Pierre Cochereau, Richard Strauss, and Gustav Mahler. Briggs also spends much time improvising, which he credits as helping him to compose quickly. The piece Four Concert Etudes was commissioned by organist Doug Cleveland, former artist in residence at the University of Washington. Cleveland simply requested that Briggs write something really hard. These four etudes are French-inspired music, with each title indicating the technical skill to be developed. Titling each etude in this manner directly connects the four concert etudes with the six etudes written by Jean Dimitrescu in the mid-20th century. In this way, Briggs is placing his music in line with the ancient tradition of the past, while striving to create new music. Briggs' set of etudes begins with an introduction, which introduces the main themes that appear throughout the work. After the initial introduction, etude 1, octaves, begins with a rapid broken octave passage in the pedal, requiring agility and accuracy in playing all tones. The manuals join in the octave study for a few moments, as in measures 53 through 56. Beginning in measure 63, Briggs starts to vary the pedal octave pattern. Instead, having one foot play a heel toe pattern on the interval of a second, followed by the other foot doing the same pattern an octave above. Measures 96 through 97 and 100 through 101 feature another shift in pattern for the pedals, simultaneous octave playing. This technique necessitates coordination of the feet in a way previously unexplored in the piece. After a rapid ascent of octave chords in the manuals, the second etude begins. Etude 2, Accordé alterné, alternating chords, has several distinct sections that develop two main techniques. The sections, from measures 113 through 158, Briggs inserts a section working on trills and arpeggiation, particularly in the left hand. At these moments, the main melodic material is shared between the right hand and the right foot, while the left hand motion and left foot pedal points provide a harmonic basis for the melody. Another short bridge connects A2 with A2-3, Sarabha Kavya Kuradhanam for the double pedal. This A2 develops the independence of each foot. Each must focus on creating a qualified vowel line without any assistance from the other foot. This can range from breaking a repeated note in one foot, while the other foot moves smoothly to a new note, as in measures 226 through 227, to using a heel on the left, as in measure 238 through 239. Beginning at measure 259, the double pedal gives way to pedal scalar passages, a technique that requires the artist to work out in advance how each foot will cross the other, and how to use toe heel techniques to the greatest advantage. A final bridge connects A2-3 with A2-4, tierces, thirds. This issue explores parallel major and minor thirds in various combinations of manuals and pedals. The first iteration of the tierces occurs from measures 285 through 286, with the right hand playing a rapid parallel thirds passage against chords in the left hand and pedal. Later on, in measures 293 through 299, the manuals do a slow double duet parallel thirds in octaves, while the pedal does scalar and troper underneath. After these initial opening ideas, Briggs starts to expand the combination of parts. Measures 317 through 319 has parallel thirds between the left hand and the pedal. Measure 320 has parallel thirds between the right hand and the pedal. And measures 323 through 324 has parallel thirds in augmentation in the pedals. Briggs is quick to note that these are concert patients, meaning they are intended for public performance. He feels that a good patient should be, quote, something that is not just a technical exercise. It should be a lot more than that, like you find with the Chopin patients. They are all wonderful pieces of music, in addition to being technical exercises. Conclusion. After conducting this survey of organ patients from 2000 through 2020, the composers seem to fall into two categories. The first category focuses on expanding Extended techniques like having an assistant in the face manipulating the pipes. Treating the organ as a percussion instrument with no stop drum. And using half-drawn stops. These etudes, while still challenging, may be considered etudes more for the instrument, the room, and the audience, rather than just the technical skills of the player. The composers from this survey who fall into this category are Thomas Lefort and Michael Pelton. Etudes continue to push the technique of organists in new and varied ways. Though this was a small survey in a brief period, it shows that